Hi, I'm John Filardo, Vice President for Government Relations of the American Chiropractic Association. Here with our good friend and colleague, Rick Miller. Today we're inside the friendly confines of the American Chiropractic Association in Arlington, Virginia. And Rick, let's talk a little bit about what's been happening the last couple of weeks on the political landscape. And of course, that's the conventions that are going on now. We've got the Democratic Convention in Charlotte, and last week was the Republicans down in Tampa. And you were down in the Democratic Convention in Charlotte, your home state.
Just come back.
Earlier this week, and we had a little fundraiser down there for Senator Tom Harkin from Iowa, who's at the convention, of course. And let's talk a little bit about that.
Sure, John. This was a very nice event. It was with Tom Harkin, as John indicated. Senator Harkin is chairman of the Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions Committee in the Senate, which is the major committee of jurisdiction over virtually all the health care programs. So he's a very important individual in terms of what goes on in the Congress dealing with health care. We had a very fine visit with Senator Harkin, his wife, and his chief of staff there in Charlotte with a nice little group of doctors of chiropractic. And we had a wonderful discussion, in-depth discussion about chiropractic issues dealing with Medicare, commissioning in the Uniform Corps, the United States Public Health Service, and other issues of concern to us. And it was just wonderful FaceTime with somebody like Tom Harkin, who has been a longtime, very loyal supporter. As I think our viewers probably know, Senator Harkin was the chief author of the provider non-discrimination provision that was included in the Affordable Health Care Act. So he has played and continues to play a very important role.
He was very important in that. We worked very closely with his office in making sure that got in there. As you know, that provision will not go in effect till 2014.
Right.
But what's also important to remember, and you touched upon it, not only will this apply to plans sold inside the exchanges under the new health law, but also it applies to ERISA plans.
Absolutely.
Which we've been trying to pierce that shield for many, many years, and this language does that.
Absolutely, John, and I think this is a good lesson on persistence and why we need members to stay active and to stay loyal, and stay members of the ACA and be involved over a period of years. Now, this critical provision, which is the first time that we've got a provision that applies to these ERISA plans, this provision dated back to our efforts that we, the ACA, helped spearhead, in fact, to pass a patient's bill of rights back in the 1990s. Now, we were very active back then. We had this provision very similar in a draft patient's bill of rights. Ultimately, the drive to enact a patient's bill of rights that ground to a halt. But that provision we worked on, a lot of you doctors out there supported us in that. We were able to put that in with Senator Tom Harkin's leadership into the Affordable Health Care Act. So that's a story of something that took a number of years and really wouldn't have happened had the ACA not been here and had people not been members of the ACA and kept supporting our ongoing government relations efforts.
Very well put, my friend, as always. In Tampa last week, too, we attended a fundraiser for Senator Orrin Hatch,
great friend,
Republican from Utah. And I know this is something we've talked about many times before, is that we have friends on both sides of the aisle.
Absolutely.
And it's very important that we have that.
Well, I'll tell you, it's one of those things that's personally rewarding to know that you're going out there and you're representing the profession that has friends, as you said, John, on both sides of the aisle, across the political spectrum. Good, loyal supporters of this profession, people who are concerned about wellness and holistic care and the patients that the chiropractors serve. And, you know, it's important that we reward our friends on both sides of the aisle. And so all of our doctors need to keep that in mind.
And I want to thank all of the doctors and individuals who contributed along with the ACA PAC to these two events at the conventions. It was very important that our doctors step up, and they did. And I want to thank you, everyone who contributed to the success of both of these events. Rick, let's talk a little bit now about next week. You've got the conventions, and then next week, Congress comes back.
Yes.
They have been out pretty much all of August. and they come back for what's being described as a very limited session, because they'll be in for like 11 or 12 legislative days, and then they go out again to campaign for the election in November. But they've got a very limited schedule. I think that's designed that way. The only thing that they have to pass is a bill to keep the government running, and they've already got agreement on that. Speaker Boehner and Senate Majority Leader Reid have already come to an agreement on a spending bill that will take them into next March. So that will take that aspect out of the equation in the campaigns. But once we hit November, in what I'm calling the mother of all lame duck sessions, we're going to really be seeing significant action in the House and in the Senate.
We sure will, John. And you know, I think you're right. They're going to come back here briefly for a couple of weeks. They'll pass this continuing resolution to fund the government through the end of the calendar year, at least. But in this lame duck session, here are some of the things that are coming in front of the Congress. Very important to us, unless Congress acts come the end of the year, we face an enormous cut, all providers do in Medicare, because of what's called the sustainable growth rate formula. And if Congress doesn't fix that, again, providers take a huge hit. That comes about at the end of the year. Also, you have what's called sequestration. Due to previous legislation, they're scheduled to be essentially an across-the-board cut in federal spending of about $50 billion the first year. If that goes into effect, and truthfully, most members of Congress don't want that across-the-board cut. They would rather tailor the cut to some specific programs. And then, of course, you have the expiring Bush tax cuts. So taxes go up essentially for everybody at the end of the year, again, unless Congress acts. Whether that's going to happen or not during this mother of all lame ducks, we really don't know. A lot will probably depend on the outcome of the election.
It certainly will, and of course we're going to have to be on top of it every step of the way. And what you said before about membership is very key here. We're only as strong as our membership, so we ask you to, if you're not a member of the ACA, consider joining, because again, we're going to have to be up there, and we're the ones protecting the profession on the Hill, and we're going to have to be up there virtually all November to make sure those cuts you talked about are not on our hide.
John, and it's entirely possible they go through this lame duck and don't get any of this work done. It could easily slop over into the next year. They might have to come back and try and fix things retroactively. And I'll tell you, when they get into the fine details, as you know, that's where the devil is.
Yes.
We don't want to be the ox that gets gored. So we need your continued support.
Well put, my friend. Thank you very
much. Thank you, John.
We'll see you soon.